It is said that leadership, the best leaders, are those who have learned to be extremely good followers. This is why often you'll hear that a military school will produce better leaders than a business school. The students in a business school are going through classes and they are learning a lot of theory on business and management and leadership. Whereas in a military school, they're learning how to follow their leader. When we follow someone who is an excellent leader, we are seeing modeled before us good leadership principles. When we do it this way, when we have the position of a leader, we know what good leadership looks like and we can example it for those who are following us. This is a very basic idea of leadership. Learn to be an excellent follower first, and it will lead you to be an excellent leader. In the Bible, we have many examples of those who were great leaders who mentored younger men and women into the leadership position. You have, for example, Moses mentoring Joshua. Joshua is the one who led the people into the land of Canaan, where the rest of the people of Israel had to wander in the desert. Joshua was simply Moses' servant for a very long time. He would simply help him with ordinary things. But in that experience of being with Moses, you see that his leadership was developed and his reverence for God. You also see it in the life of Elijah and Elisha. Elijah being the main leader and Elisha simply following along with him. But in that following, he learned what godliness looked like. He learned what leadership looked like. He looked like he understood how ministry should be done. You look at even David, who was loyal to not only his family, but to King Saul and to the prophet Samuel. David learned to follow Saul, even though Saul was against him. And David learned loyalty, and David learned what it means to be a good leader from two aspects. One, what to do, and also what not to do. You find that even Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these young men, these young Jewish men who were taken to captivity by the Babylonians, you see in the life of Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these young Jewish boys who were taken to captivity by the Babylonians and later by the Persians, these three often looked up to Daniel for inspiration. And you see, Daniel would not compromise when he was thrown into the lion's den as punishment for praying faithfully. Later on, you see Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego facing the same kind of situation, and they stood and would not bow down to the statue that the king had made of himself, even though they were to be thrown into the fiery furnace. And that fiery furnace was heated up 7 times hotter than normal, that the guards and soldiers who threw them in there died because of the extreme heat. Now the question is, where did Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego learn this example of staying faithful to God and to the truth, no matter what, even if it cost them their life? They learned that from their friend, their leader, Daniel. You find even in Jesus' life, Jesus picked these 12 men to be his closest followers. And in this, he did not pick superstars or people who were extraordinary, but he simply picked ordinary people who he could mentor and train, and he called them and said, "Come, be with me, and I will make you fishers of men." And so these disciples, as we know, Peter and Thomas and James and John and many others, were there simply following Jesus along, and they made many mistakes. They made many problems. They said things they should not say. They did things they should not do. And yet Jesus was patient with them and would teach them and would example everything in his life. If you look at the life of Jesus, you see that everything he taught, he also modeled in his personal life. See, great leaders are not only those who are excellent at their work ethic, but also wonderful examples in their private life. Jesus told these men, "Come, follow me, be with me, live with me for the next 3.5 years, and I will make you fishers of men." Paul the Apostle took the same attitude and said, "Follow me as I follow Christ." There are not too many leaders today who would say that to someone and say, "You can follow my work ethic, my family life, my married life, how I raise children, how I do the ministry, how I handle money, how I treat others, follow my example." And yet Paul was able to say that. So here Jesus, the greatest leader ever, was able to model what good leadership looked like by calling these men to simply follow him, and in their following, they learned what good leadership looked like, and they learned how to follow well. And you see, Peter became a leader, James became a leader, Thomas, the disciple of Christ who came to India AD 52, became a leader. You see these ordinary men who became great leaders in the early church and also in the ministry later on. You see, Paul, on the Damascus Road, where he was a persecutor of the believers, and his agenda, already being a leader in the Sanhedrin, being a Pharisee, he wanted to do what he thought was right, and he wanted to stamp out these new believers. And so he went from place to place, killing or giving permission for these Christians to be jailed and killed. Stephen, one of those who had a very tender heart, was killed at the feet of Paul with his authority. I think that image of Stephen looking into heaven with such a merciful and gracious face in kindness as he died must have haunted Paul for a very long time. And yet Paul, on the way to Damascus, on the Damascus Road, Jesus met him. A bright light shone on him. He fell off his horse, and a voice said, "Paul, Paul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" He said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." And from that moment on, Paul's life would never be the same. He ended up not being the persecutor of the believers, but being one among them and being one of the greatest apostles who would carry the message of Christ's love to so many places more than anyone else. He is responsible for writing most of the New Testament and giving us the instructions in how to follow Jesus and how to conduct ourselves in worship and how to have unity among the believers and how to exercise the gifts of the Spirit in a proper way to bring unity rather than disunity. Now, Paul, when he became a believer and started following Jesus, there was Barnabas. And you read the scriptures and it says, Barnabas and Paul, Barnabas and Paul, Barnabas and Paul. Later on, it became Paul and Barnabas. And later on from there, it became Paul and Timothy. But see, Barnabas was the son of encouragement. He was a man who did not give up on people. A great leader is one who encourages his people. It's said you can catch more flies with honey than vinegar. It's true. But you can also help more people with encouragement than just correction. Correction is needed, but encouragement is for the heart to sustain yourself to keep going. Barnabas is one of the only ones who stood with Paul when everyone else was afraid. I would be afraid, you would be afraid to have Paul nearby you when his testimony and his claim to fame is that he killed lots of Christians. And here, Barnabas is mentoring Paul. He's leading Paul. Even though Paul in his education is much higher, and his family background is much higher, in his ability to speak and logic and reason is much higher than Barnabas. But yet Paul learned to follow Barnabas well. This is one of the secrets of Paul's life, how he became such an exceptional leader, is he learned to follow well. Later, Paul became one of the main people in the church. And of course, like I mentioned, he wrote much of the New Testament, and he laid down a lot of things in terms of how people heard the gospel around the different countries. Paul, on his journeys, picked up a young man named Timothy. And Timothy might have been about 15 or 16 years old when he began to be with Paul. And for the next 15 or so years, Timothy faithfully followed Paul everywhere he went and did what Paul told him to do, either staying at one place or teaching these people or carrying this letter or bringing things to him. But in this ordinary, sometimes mundane things, Timothy learned proper leadership. Later on, Paul would be beheaded in Rome and would lose his life, and Paul would write his last letter to Timothy in 2 Timothy and would tell Timothy, "Timothy, carry on the ministry. It's up to you now. God has started this good work and will continue it through you." And so Paul gives the mantle of leadership to Timothy, this young, timid man who didn't really have a lot of formal education like Paul or could speak like Paul or, you know, had a lot of struggles and inferiority. And yet Timothy became one of the great leaders in the church. How is this possible? Because Timothy learned to follow well. See, when Jesus called his disciples and said, "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men," what Jesus was saying is, "Come and live with me. See my life, my public life. See my private life. See how I handle money. See how I handle those who are lower than me, those who are higher than me. See how I handle the leper, the beggar, the men, the women, the lady that was caught in prostitution or in adultery. See how I forgive and how I heal. See how I provide for the poor. Listen to my teaching and see in my private life if it's the same." What Jesus was saying to his disciples, these random group of men, he said, "You come and see my life." And it's interesting, when you go to the Gospels and you read, the first question that the disciples asked Jesus was, "Where do you live?" Now, for some of us, that sounds like a very funny idea. Of all the questions you could ask the Son of God, "Where do you live?" is not a very bright question. But as you know, oftentimes when we are conversing with someone or a stranger, we meet them for the first time, we'll ask them what their name is, and we'll listen carefully what their name is, because their name may tell us where they're from or what background they're from or which district they're from. We will also listen to their accent, how they talk, because that will tell you from what area they're from, even if they speak the same language. My cousin was on vacation somewhere from Germany, and he was at this particular place, and he heard someone speaking Schwäbisch, which is a dialect of German from the area where my grandmother's from. And my cousin got up and went to the person and said, "Are you from this and this place?" And he said, "Yes." And he said, "So am I." How did he know? Because he heard Schwäbisch being spoken, a dialect of that particular part of Germany, which is spoken nowhere else. And so not only do we ask their name so we can know where are you from, but we also listen to their accent so we can know how they talk. Maybe are they educated or not educated? Do they come from that particular place or the other kind of place? Then we will go into this long type of questioning back and forth. You know, what does your father do? What does your mother do? Who are you? What kind of job do you have? And we'll ask, "Do you know so-and-so? Do you know that shopkeeper in that place? Oh, I met someone on vacation there. Do you know them?" And we will try to somehow make a connection. Even if it's through 100 people, we will try to make some kind of connection with them because we want to identify that we somehow know them. And all of that is important because we are basically doing the same thing that the disciples did. Jesus, where do you stay? We know your accent. We know your name. We know supposedly who you are. Tell us about your place, your home. And for us, what that means is when someone asks, who is your father? Who is your grandfather? What do they do? It immediately tells us who they are as a person. See, in the Western understanding, each person is an individual apart from their family. It does not matter what your family does, good or bad, you as an individual are an individual, and you can do whatever you want, and it does not affect your family. Your family can do whatever they want, it does not affect you. But in the Eastern understanding, and also in the biblical understanding, and even in our country here, whatever I do affects my family, whatever my family does affects me. The good of that is I always can trace my roots. The bad of that is I lose hope sometimes if my family is not so good and I feel like my life is doomed or I am condemned to live a life of anguish because of my family. The truth is God has made you an individual and God has given you a family, but what God has given us is over 30,000 promises in His Word that tells us that whatever He does in our life is good, that He stands with us, that His plans for us are unique to us. But here Jesus is being asked by the disciples, where do you live? And so we see the disciples went there and saw where Jesus stayed, and you flip the page and you see they come back saying, we have found the Messiah. We have found the Messiah. And this is important because whatever they saw or heard where Jesus was staying proved to them that He was the Messiah. We don't know what that is, but just like when you ask someone, who is your father, who is your mother, who is your grandfather, what do they do, where are you from? It tells us a lot about them, and if we were to visit their home, we would know them. Gail Irwin, the author of The Jesus Style, which is a fantastic book, and I would encourage you to read it. He says, give me 5 minutes with your children, and I will know who you are as a parent. It's so true. Sometimes I will go and pick up my children from school, and I will see some of the kids stamping their feet or yelling or punching or getting angry or getting, you know, shaking their head. And I will think, the only place they learn that from is at home. Why? Because our children follow us. They become like us. They are small versions of us. They are mini-me's of us. And here Jesus invited these disciples and said, come to where I stay, see where I live. And when they came back, they said, what we have seen proves that this is the Messiah that we have found. Now, when you think of Moses and Joshua, when you think of Elijah and Elisha, and you think of Saul and David, and you think of Jesus and the disciples, and Paul and Timothy, the thing that all of them had in common, it was not teaching that they received, it was life that they received. How? By being with them and seeing their private life, not on a showcase, but simply being with them as life moved along. You want to be an excellent teacher? Example your life before the students. Class is good. Outside the classroom is more important. You as a pastor or a minister or a clergy, you want to have the greatest impact on your people? Example life before them. Sunday messages are good, but life is more important. You want to lead your people in the company? in a way that they trust you. Example before them your life. Have consistency of character in your life. Don't ever say one thing and then do the opposite. You want your children to grow up in a godly way, then always speak the truth. Never steal money. Never bribe. Never take advantage. Now, this is seems impossible. Like, this is opposite of what society tells us, but this is what the Bible says. If you want your children to grow up doing all kinds of crazy things, then show them that you say one thing and you do the opposite. Show them that you say one thing in public and in private, you are the opposite. That is a guaranteed success to ruin your children. If you want your children to grow up in godliness, then show them that you are the same person in public as you are in private. That when you make a mistake, you ask forgiveness. That when you have done wrong, you correct it. Show them how you even ask forgiveness from your husband or from your wife. Why? Because that young boy who's growing up in your family needs to see that when he gets married, he knows how to respect women. And that young girl who's growing up in the family watching the mother and father needs to know that a mother can also ask forgiveness from the children or from the husband and vice versa. Whatever you do as a couple will paint the picture of marriage and godliness and the kind of spouse that child will look for later on when they are considering marriage. Even if it's an arranged marriage, they will have these thoughts in mind even in that case. But the most important thing that we see in Scripture is that these men were simply great followers of their leader. And in turn, God used that to make great leaders out of them. And they had followers, and it continued on and on and on. And one of the greatest examples that we see is Paul mentoring Timothy and the letters that he wrote to Timothy. Helping this young man who is timid, shy, and not well to become a great leader, not only through instruction, but through life and life being imparted to him through that example. I would encourage you to read 1 and 2 Timothy and also our Metropolitan's book called Against the Wind, which is a detailed study of 2 Timothy, where Paul tells Timothy, many people are doing these things, but for you, you do this. Over and over again, Paul tells Timothy, but for you, you do this. But for you, you do this. And of course, Paul exampled all these things. I would encourage you, if you don't have a Bible of your own, please write to us and we'll help you to get a Bible. Also, if you're interested in knowing more about the book I mentioned, The Jesus Style by Gail Irwin, I would encourage you to write or call us. And also, the wonderful book by our Metropolitan, Against the Wind, A Detailed Study in 2 Timothy, which I know all of these will encourage your life so much. Let's pray and ask the Lord to help us understand these things. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We ask, Lord, that you would help us as we understand what it means to follow well, so that if you give us the position of leadership in any form or fashion, even if it's simply to lead our family or to lead our children or a Sunday school class or teaching or whatever it may be, how great or small, that we would understand the great privilege that you have given to us. Father, please help us to understand that we must be examples in our private life, not only in our public life. We pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. My brother, my sister, remember this. The Bible has the answers for life, and God's promises always comes true. May the Lord bless you as you experience His grace and mercy and peace in your life today.